name's George Milliken. I'm with Education Scotland's digital team. We're absolutely delighted to be able to host Daydream Believers, a great group of people with absolutely fantastic resources and ideas for learning and teaching. So, and I think as we go back to schools perhaps, and we're working in a blended model that might be unfamiliar, I think to have resources that are, I think we're going to have to be creative, and so I think to have resources that really encourage and promote that are absolutely perfect. And I just feel that as a teacher, any time that there's something that you can use that's ready-made and somebody's really thought it all out for you, that's always a win. So hopefully the stuff that Helena, I'll let her introduce herself from Daydream's got is going to be really useful for everybody. So if there are any issues with bandwidth, and it's probably going to be my computer, somebody in either call will pick up for us and we'll get it back as quickly as possible. I am going to try and record the webinar, so hopefully if there are any issues we drop out, we'll be able to cut that together and have something to show at the end. So yeah, thanks so much. That's everything from me.
Okay, thanks George. So you've just joined us. If you can mute yourself on Zoom, that would be great, so you're not hearing a kind of any background noise. I thought it would be quite good just to sort of, you know, very often, I don't know about you, but you come into Zoom and you're, you know, have I got it? Is it going to work? And I thought it'd be actually just nice just to take a moment and have to take a bit of breathing space. Sometimes what I find with myself after meetings that I've been in the meeting with my shoulders up around my ears, and you suddenly realise, oh, right, okay, I should actually sit back in the chair. And I think it is difficult, this new normal. You know, normally it would be lovely to meet you, and there's many people out there that we've met through the Daydream Believers programme, and there's something lovely about a breathing space. When you meet people, you can hear them breathe. Zoom and Teams and that, you know, we can't hear you, and that's hard. But I want you just, if you can, to switch off from what's been going on, emails, phones, family, and just to see, can you give yourself just an hour just to have a think, just to kind of gather your thoughts, and really to be aware of, you know, we're all juggling this, we're all in this together. As somebody calls it, it's not even working from home, it's living at work at the minute, and that's a challenge. So everyone's winging it. This was I'm a lecturer for 25 years at Edinburgh College. I teach design, and one of our partners on the Daydream Believers program, Emil Bloom, an amazing guy who has been done a power of work on the project, is a huge ally for me. And he came in, and this was the phrase he told the students. Now you can imagine, from a student's point of view, this was a little bit upsetting, having invested in 3 years of education to be told that actually everybody's winging it. But in a way, now more than ever, he's been proven to be right. I'm completely winging this this afternoon. If you could see outside of this little box here, you would see exactly how I'm winging it. We don't have great broadband, so I have a huge cable that's gone up here, up around here, back up through my daughter's bedroom. Everyone in the house has been told not to move, never mind not go on Wi-Fi. They've been told stay in your room, do not move for an hour. And I've just got fingers crossed that, you know, the God of broadband will hold us all together. So winging it is an essential skill, and it's a skill that we're all using at the minute. Another thing that I talk to my students about is this phrase, and it actually comes from Pixar, and it's really how they kind of brief most of their stories. Tell me a story, make me care. And this is very much what my challenge, I think, today is for all of you, is to tell you our story. Some of the partners from the Daydream Believers are here, which is wonderful to see them on Zoom. And just to share with you what has happened, and also maybe why we think people should connect with this project, and how we're hoping that this might become part of your story. When you think about it, at the minute, we've had so many things stripped away from us. I was thinking back to when we went into lockdown, and I took our family calendar and I started to strip off all the things that weren't going to happen, no longer from, oh, there goes my holiday, okay, and you just And there was a sense of grief about all the things that we lost, and particularly for those of us who are teaching, there was an end point that we were no longer going to be able to celebrate our primary sevens, our sixth years, our class of 2020. We're not going to have the goodbyes that we thought they should have had. And when I kind of looked at my calendar, it was quite sad, because all I was kind of left with was bin days and birthdays. And, you know, there's not an awful lot to look forward to on bin days, but they've become very much a height of excitement, certainly where we live. Getting the right bin out has become itself a challenge. But when you strip away everything, which is what we've really had to do at the minute with education, when you take away what I'm calling the bricks and the ticks, this is what we're left with. We're left with knowledge and community. And we're left with our ability to share knowledge and our ability to break and to make and create community. And while we've had to grieve for what we've lost, what I think is, in stripping a lot of what we've had to do away, we've actually created something that I think is really exciting. So this is pre-COVID, so you'll notice there's no 2 meter distance in this gift, but what the story really behind Daydream Believers has been one of collaboration. And the most exciting thing for me as part of the team has been where we all moved away from doing what we used to do at primary school. Remember in school, you hid yourself, you know, don't you copy me, and you put your arm around it. And I think in education, we've been incredibly guilty of doing that. Colleges don't talk to universities, schools don't talk to colleges. And you begin to think, well, actually, if we just stripped all that away and we came together, you know, what would we be left with? So over the course of 2 to 3 years, we worked with these various schools, and particularly with Shona Primrose, Katie Simpson and Philippa Drummond, three teachers from Tynecastle, Balerno and Drummond. And we worked with them alongside the universities, and we basically said, okay, come and share your knowledge and help us build a community. And we did this alongside business partners, businesses like White Space agencies, also talking to Education Scotland, and just thought, you know, let's forget who owns this, and let's forget about the product. Let's actually just sit around the table, pull your chair up, let's have a discussion. And today, I suppose, part of my invite goes out to you is, can you help us? You know, this is not a ta-da story. This is about reaching out to all of you this afternoon and saying, we need your help. Can you help us? Can you pull a chair up to the table and share your insights with us? When we looked at collaboration, we thought, well, how do we come together and how do we have a brief? And we looked at this and we said, if we strip away all the different E's and O's of different outcomes, and we look at the future and we look at the workforce and we look at the skills, because in a sense, that's what we're all creating, is the future workforce. So when we looked at the World Economic Forum and we looked at the skills, and it was for many of us a bit of a wake-up call, because we began to look at it and go, some of the stuff that we've traditionally in colleges put a massive amount of emphasis on, traditionally in education, is not as growing as fast as skills in analytical thinking, active learning. And we've seen this, and you will have seen this borne out, even if you've had students who've applying for university places, very often in their personal statement, what the universities and colleges want to see is, don't tell me about the grades, don't tell me about how your father took you on a work placement. Tell me about what you can do with the stuff that you have. Tell me about how you are creative, where you've used your initiative, where you've been active, and where you've innovated. And that is encouraging. So in the Daydream Believers, what we did was look at the brief and say, okay, how do we take problem solving, critical thinking, and creativity? And how do we embed this into the curriculum? A particular sort of challenge, I think, at this was to help us to move away from the very product-driven side of education, the ticks. And while that's essential in terms of it helps us, it reassures us, but we also thought, well, if our future is more uncertain than ever, we need to focus back on the process. So we need to support our young people to tell us about the process rather than have an end goal of, tell me what I need to do to get an A. Tell me what I need to do to pass this. And if we let go of that and we actually don't focus so much on the product and we say, well, let's go on a journey. Let's go on a journey and we don't know what the product will be, but we'll teach you the skills that will take you through the process. For us, all of the team working on it, that was the most exciting. So we set the challenge, and the challenge was, how can we help our young people to create, design, build, and inhabit our the future, inhabit the world? We spoke to our teachers on the pilot, and this was a thing that one of them said that really rang kind of true for me. And I thought about all the kind of CPD opportunities I wanted to go on, and I couldn't get out of class, or I couldn't get the funding, and I thought about the number of times I've just kind of tried to take something and jiggle it around and put it back into the classroom in another name. And that kind of became our call, and we said, let's not focus on telling teachers or telling education what needs to change. Let's actually resource the change. Let's give the resources that at the very cold face, people can take into their classroom, they can use, they can adapt, they can do whatever they want with them, they can use them as a brick, they will be free and always be free, and they will be given in a spirit of generosity, but also in a spirit of, you help us. What else can we do here to bring about change, to add more resources? So this is a sort of a quick insight into how the web page work. I'm sure many of you have, who are our old friends to the program, will have seen how it works. Through funding, really, we had to sort of take, you know, we weren't able to build the website from scratch, so we took a template that is very much like a shopping channel. You pick something, you add it to your cart. When you add it to your cart, you can then check out. When you check out, what you get is a zip file that gives you a lesson plan. In the very lesson plan, what you get is a Word document that takes each of these lessons and splits it up into 50-minute lessons. That Word document is yours to add whatever descriptive terminology you need, whatever E's and O's you want to fit next to it. But we've also given you a presentation. And the presentation, in a sense, allows you to sit back and watch and work alongside the pupils. It takes you step by step through every part of it. So that's basically kind of how it works. You can, as many of the teachers said to us, the wonderful thing we were able to do was to scan through it quite quickly and then go into the classroom with it. But we've also found that the resources have been able to use right across the curricula. So in universities and colleges, in secondary schools and primary schools, because we've moved from this focus of the outcome to the process, it allows you to change these things and adapt them. So this is kind of basically where it sits at the minute. We have, I think, over 250 hours worth of content sitting on the web page. We were really excited about a month or so ago, we were able to launch Lego. And for all of the team, this was probably one of the most exciting projects, not least just even been able to go and visit Lego in London. And we were really touched with their openness on this project. They just said, yes, we think this is worthwhile and we want to help you. So they've written two 50-minute lessons for us that we think would be really interesting on return to schools. It's about storytelling, and it asks each of the pupils to create their own Lego characters and to tell the story through that. And I think, for me personally, and I think this is where I come back to the only thing I know to be real in my actual story, is I'm scared about what's going to happen when I go back in September. I'm nervous about the students that I haven't really heard that much from. I'm I'm worried about the stories that might, you know, come through. But I think Lego is an interesting one, because it's an interesting one of allowing our pupils to maybe tell that story, to tell how brave they've been without having it to be so intense. So just like Lego is a building block, you might find that that 50-minute lesson allows you to build. So there may be things, if you look here, we've got stories and starters. You know, there's too much pollution in the harbour. That could be something that could lead to another lesson. Someone is feeling lonely. Something may come out about what was happening in lockdown. So again, what we're saying, it's just a starter. It's something that you can build and you can grow from. And we also looked at very quickly at how we could assess all of this, because I know for many of us, the worry about having to go back into schools and just dust down the textbooks and not even start play, but try and do fast forward. If there is going to be an exam diet, how do I get them back up and running? And what we tried to look at is, well, what if we look and reward the process, which in a sense, when all the exams and that were stripped away, is exactly what we had to go back and do. So this is a method that's used by Ruth and Richard from Edinburgh Navy University. And what they do is they reward the process. So as you see up here, this is about innovation and research. This is about the thinking. This is about the idea. Where's the concept? And how does that link to the research? This part is about failure. So you tried something, you created something that didn't really work. What did you learn from it? This part is tell me a story, make me care. And this part is your bravery. And how they work, and as you see here, is this is your D here, and then that becomes the A. And what they find with this is that it was really reassuring for students, the university students, to see how the whole part of this process connected. So, you know, you were able to say, well, you're doing really well here. This is a really brave idea. But, you know, we needed to push it more in the conceptual thinking. So the other thing we looked at is how do we link up with other collaborators? And this is the work we've done with Skills Development Scotland, taking their meta skills, curiosity, creativity, sense making and critical thinking, and trying to look and embed that within some kind of award, some kind of qualification. And this is something that the team are looking at the minute. And this will be what we're hoping will be a collaboration with schools, colleges, and universities to create something like this. So everything was going to plan, and then we hit into where we are now, basically. And what really happened for many of us, and I think this kind of rang true for me in my journey as a lecturer, and I would describe it like this. I stood in front of the class, having taught for 25 years. I stood in front of the class and said, I think I know where we're going. I think I can take you from A to B. And then COVID happened. Oh, there's just some people coming in. You're very welcome there. If you've just joined us from the waiting room, I'm sorry you've just joined us. If you can mute yourself, that would be brilliant.
Yes.
Brilliant. Thank you. So what I had to go from was, I think I have a fair idea how this is going to end up, to lockdown and COVID. I have no idea. I have no idea what's happening. And then standing alongside my class and saying to them, here's an idea. Here's an idea of something we could do. So just about this time, we started working with an organization called D&AD. And they created for us a series of lessons based around the theme of creative bravery. And I'm just going to show you, hopefully, George, we've got our fingers crossed now this goes well, but I'm just going to show you one of the videos from the lesson that they created. There are five 50-minute lessons, and this video features in the first lesson, and it's about the fearless girl.
The problem is this. Women are not making it to the top of any profession anywhere in the world.
So many times, and it still gets me. It still makes me quite emotional, and in particular when I see the young girl with her arms and her hips, and I think that this is an interesting and perhaps an innovative way of looking at bravery amongst our young people as they return. We've all had to be fearless, and the very fact that your pupils will make it back in August into schools means that they have been fearless. And I just love that image of the little girl and her hips. And I think if we go back into the idea of the building blocks, and you know, who knew how important statues were going to become in our society at the minute. And I think that, you know, there is lots of elements that you as teachers have and ideas and insights that you could build on that. And you know, for me as a lecturer, when I become overwhelmed at the minute with how toilets are going to work out, and am I going to be in on a Tuesday and on a Wednesday, and how's that going to happen, when I become overwhelmed with that, what reassures me is coming back and saying, change what you control. I as a lecturer know how to teach. I have a fair idea. I know what pupils are like, and I can plan a curriculum. I have to learn new skills, I have to build a community, and I have to share my knowledge. But things like this are a wonderful building block for what could happen. And the wonderful thing about working with D&AD is that, quite sadly, in the design profession, they are an organisation that many people in the creative industries aspire to win one of their yellow pencils. So this is kind of, I suppose, a testament to how sad we are, in a way, that you sort of feel, gosh, you would die happy if you had a yellow pencil. But the wonderful thing for Daydream Believers is that we now have access to this massive resource of award-winning, innovative, impactful campaigns and work that's been done, that we're currently working with D&AD to develop up more resources and grow it. And we've become, which is a huge accolade for the team and for Daydream Believers, we've become their school program, which is massive. So I'm just going to show you, hopefully, one other video that is part of this, the Ben, you're very welcome. You're just joining us. That's brilliant. Thank you. So hopefully, let me just try this. Yes. So I'm just going to share this one with you.
If people say your dreams are crazy, if they laugh at what you think you can do, good, stay that way. Because what non-believers fail to understand is that calling a dream crazy is not an insult, it's a compliment. Don't try to be the fastest runner in your school or the fastest in the world. Be the fastest ever. Don't picture yourself wearing OBJ's jersey. Picture OBJ wearing yours. Don't believe you have to be like anybody to be somebody. If you're born a refugee, don't let it stop you from playing for the national team. Don't become the best basketball player on the planet. Be bigger than basketball. Believe in something, even if it means sacrificing everything. When they talk about the greatest team, make sure it's your team. If you have only one hand, don't just watch football. Play at the highest level. And if you're a girl from Compton, become the greatest athlete ever. Yeah, that's more like it. So don't ask if your dreams are crazy. Ask if they're crazy enough.
So that's another interesting story and video that could spark a conversation in your classrooms. There's lots of aspects to that. Were Nike right? Is it the right thing to use this as a platform? What happened after the advert was raised? Why were people starting to burn their shoes? Did it have an impact for Nike? And I think that it's just a taster, it's just a way of bringing in that conversation. But what we found with the resources that we've been given and the resources on Daydream is in a short space of time, they can have an impact. And as one of the pupils said to us when they were using them on the pilot, they said, we like them because it looks shiny. And in many cases, lots of the teachers have kind of fed back to us and said, we like them because they don't look educational, which is kind of weird, but maybe true. So I'm just going to take you just very quickly back into the next part of the story. So the kind of contingency plan, the what's happened. So I mentioned to you at the beginning when I was talking about my journey is that what should have been happening at this time of year is that I would be in a staff room and we would be planning our summer lunch out, a possible sports day, and certainly a feeling of winding down, of having accomplished something, of having got a group of people from A to B. And there's something so comforting when you look back and you think about that, but life really, it doesn't necessarily work like that. It's more like this. So maybe this, for many of us, is what our COVID journey has been like. Initially, at the beginning, there may have been a kind of honeymoon. This is quite nice. I don't have to commute. I'm in my own house. I can get, you know, painting. I've mapped out about 3 pages of work that was going to get done in the house. I was going to write a book. I was going to become a yoga master. And I was going to learn to be fluent in Spanish. I've done nothing. I haven't lifted a book. I have tried a little bit of yoga, but I really haven't ticked off the list. And maybe that's where this bit comes in. But what did happen was I managed, through the aspect of things like this, I managed to find a group of people that felt very similar to me in terms of what they felt about education. And we talked about our journey. We discovered new problems. And possibly and hopefully what it feels like is rather than the A to B having gone along the straight line, that where we are now is a B that is in a different place. And in some ways, it feels a more interesting and a more exciting place. This is probably descriptive of what I was feeling just before I joined the webinar. You know that moment when you go, really, what was I thinking? You know, it would be so nice if it was just in a room, you could hear people breathe and you weren't telling everybody to mute. And here I am in my room and it might all go poof. And that was the stomach and knots. And I think that for many of us, our journey and being creatively brave can be described in these moments. You all will have moments out there where you've tried something different. Your stomach was in knots, your heart was racing, and you had the nervous jitters. And that really led us to working with D&AD and the lessons here. And the interesting thing about being creatively brave is to be able to say, I don't know. And that is difficult as a teacher. It's hard because in a sense, your pupils, my pupils, were looking at me going, well, what's happening? Do you know? And having to have the humility to stand in front of them and Zoom and go, I don't know. I don't know if your exams are going to count. I don't know if there's going to be exams. All I know that's real is this will be part of your story. And whatever happens, that you as the class of 2020, that this will be your badge of honor. The stories that they shared and the stories that I shared with you talk about bravery and talk about revolution. They're interesting words. About a month ago, the group of people, the collective that we worked with, came together and said, well, why don't we look at trying to bring knowledge and community together? If that's all that we've got left, if that's what there is, why not find a way in this global world that we are now more connected to look at creative bravery and celebrate it in a festival? And from the Daydream Believers point of view, what we saw was this was a natural extension to what we had been working on in the last couple of years. And we were delighted as a team to be able to pull our chair up to the table and to share our expertise. The brief that we've been given is to look at how creative bravery could reimagine education. And the way that we think we might do it is to share our stories, which is a link back to what we talked about at the beginning. Tell me a story, make me care. We hope that your stories, everyone's stories, everyone who has an interest in reimagining education, and I'm talking about you as a parent, I'm talking about carers, grandparents, businesses, all the people that have been engaged in our education process. It no longer is bricks and sticks, bricks and ticks. Bricks and ticks, need to say that really carefully. Bricks and ticks. It no longer is that. What it is about is moving out of this model and moving from how can we help? And in sharing our story, that things will change. So the proposal is that we are going to launch the festival on Friday. If you go on the webpage, and I'll give you the webpage at the end there, there may be a few tickets left. There are over 300 people signed up for this event on Zoom. Now, if I wasn't having the nervous jitters and the stomach upsets and that before that, well, that is enough, honestly, just dippy over the edge at the minute. My eye is twitching. But what we would like to do is to launch it. And at the launch, LEGO are going to be there, the Strategic Director of Education for the City of London, one of my pupils, a high school, a head teacher. All of these people are going to very quickly share their insights into what they think creative bravery is about. And the reason here we have the campfire is this is how we think it should work. Going back to the idea of not focusing on the product, to focus on the process. Our call to you, our call to everyone who has some ability to resonate with the reimagining education is to set up a campfire. Between now and the end and August, we would love you to find your tribe, to gather together groups of people that share the same vision as you, that feel and want to be creatively brave. And if you feel as a teacher that you can't come there as someone from your school, then come there as Katie, come there as Philippa, come there as Michael. Just pull your chair up and see what happens. So begin to think about who do you want, who could you create and have around your campfire. And what will happen then is that when we come back in August, we will look at pitching up tents. So from your campfire conversation, we would like to create a series of tents that would feature at the festival. Over the course of that time, we will take the stories of creative bravery that emerge from the campfire, and we will share them through the web page. If you think about it, this is our vision. And it's quite ironic that it has goalposts at it, because what we hope is that this festival resources the reimagination of education. The very idea that it's a field should give across this equity. And that's something that's been really important for all of us. And I think it has been a big concern for us too, when we think about our pupils returning to school. Our lessons on Daydream Believers can bring equity, because it's not about the math sheets and the English lessons that they've done. It's about creative bravery. And creative bravery is a lovely way of leveling things out, because for the very fact, you may not even be feeling creatively brave, but the very fact you are here today is a sign that you have been creatively brave. Going shopping, looking after your elderly parents, just keeping a family going, has all required each and every one of us to be brave and to be creative. And our vision for the festival is that everyone gets an opportunity to pitch their tent, rather like a pop-up. And how you pitch it, it comes from your conversations at the campfire, from your stories. And this is a way for many of us to look at a way of bringing community, of creating not just a national, but a global community. And that certainly has been one of the most encouraging things about the whole thing, is the global aspect and also the global connection to the idea. This isn't a great photo because it came off Twitter, but I saw it a couple of weeks ago and I loved the idea. This is a nursery school who are thinking about their return and what they're going to do. So while we're kind of talking at the minute about digital tents on, and the festival, and to a large extent will be online, there may be offline opportunities for the festival. There may be tents that you want to put in your school. This may be a way of looking around classrooms and sharing what's going on there. So the festival will run in the last week of September, and there's more information about it on the web page. So I come to a part of it where it's a little bit like, I suppose, a call to action. I think in education, we like to talk about starting and we like to talk about changing things, but sometimes in talking about it, we miss the moment. Sometimes when we're not creatively brave and just take the leap, that the moment passes. I would love each of you to just, if you have a pen and a bit of paper, to just take a minute or two and to write these questions down. What are you focused on? What are you curious about? And how have you been brave? And I think they're really, really interesting questions. What are you focused on? What are you curious about? And how are you being brave? These are the questions that LEGO use in their meetings when all of the directors come together. And when Claire from LEGO shared this with me, I had such a sense of, oh, you know, imagine if all our departmental meetings started with this. Imagine if that was our call to action. If actually these were the questions that we asked all of our young people, all of our students, all of our teachers, all of our businesses. Wouldn't it be really interesting what happened with that meeting? Wouldn't it be a really interesting conversation? For me, when I look at what are you focused on, it's difficult at the minute. I don't know about you, but you find your focus moves from emails that need to be done, students that need to reply, and just staring into the dishwasher hoping that some answers come. But I am curious, and I'm really curious about what will happen if we take on this challenge, and if we are brave. And I'm curious about how we can share our knowledge, and I'm curious about the communities that will come from this. I love this quote. What I really love about it is we don't have to wait for permission. And I don't know if you've had this sense, but there's something weird about living and working from home. There's something weird even now about delivering this out of my living room, because you sort of kind of look around and you think, should I be telling someone I'm doing this? Should I let someone know I'm here? Should I be talking to someone else about this? And in a sense, when we wait for permission, we lose the ability to be curious, and we lose perhaps some of that creative bravery. I really like that call to reimagine education, but more importantly, I absolutely love the words together and right now. And I think that each of us together could do this. And a massive shout out to Scotland. I think it's brilliant that you, and I'm Irish, just in case you hadn't picked that up, but I think it's lovely that in Scotland you have a film called Brave, and the characters are brave. That somewhere in Pixar they looked at the word bravery and they thought about the characters and the nation that summarizes and symbolizes bravery. So while we look at our festival being global, we really want to think about it being rooted in Scotland, and that bravery comes out of that and informs what goes on. So this is an opportunity. So this is nearly me. These are some of the bits of information. If you want to take a photo of that, if you haven't already followed Daydream Believers, we would love you to do that. That's an email that you can use to send us an email. That's some of the information on the creative bravery. If you're lucky and go on there fairly soon, you may be able to get a few of the tickets for the launch on Friday. But I do believe it's going to be recorded if you're not able to attend. And if you're not able to attend but already have an idea, then just, you know, get in touch, share your story. So, George, I'm kind of almost believing that this has worked, that Zoom and Teams have begun to talk together. I know that there's been some chat about it. I know also that George has got some of the links there. And he's got an evaluation forms. If there are any questions of that, if you want to sort of either just email them to me or email them to George. The Daydream Believers, all of the website, and including some of the videos, and I would encourage you to look at some of the videos which are the background to the story. If you give me, I think I've got 5 minutes. So I could actually, I think, maybe, let me just see, this is where it might all just go, eat talk. I'm just going to show you, so let me, give me a minute, we'll come back in here. So you should be able to see the screen. This is the web page as it exists here at the minute. You'll see that. So if I just go back up to the top, if you do nothing else, the simplest thing to do is just to go and click on this button, Explore Our Resources. But if you go in here, you can see some of the believers, so some of the companies that have worked with us, along with some really interesting video content, particularly White Space and Amaze Realize and Skyscanner. They've done a kind of a day in the life of the agency, which might help you. If we scroll down to here, you can see this is a 1 minute who, what, why of the program that's worth maybe sharing with any colleagues that don't know anything about the program, weren't able to make it. This is a way of you giving us feedback, which would be brilliant. If you have, or you have a partner, or you are out there in business and you would like to work and create a resource, this is a way of getting in touch. And this is a way as an organization for you to do the same. You can download a demo lesson. And then here, if you click on the Vimeo button, it will take you to a series of different videos that we've collated over the past 3 years. And hopefully, if we click on this, what should happen is this comes up. And the one that I am hoping, fingers crossed, that we can show you is this one here.
Project is working with industry. I think it's so important for the students to be able to see what's outside in the real world and bring that into the classroom. And this project's made that so easy. I think it's really exciting to have the opportunity to influence kids when they're at quite a critical part of their studies, where they're choosing subjects and they're being asked already to think about what kind of careers they're going into. For them to see someone that, you know, is in a career that they really love and they find that it's really enjoyable and fun, I think it will help inspire them. We're able to give them different skills that they can use, and maybe this will help influence their career choice in the future.
It kind of shakes up the standards, the norm, and I think that's a really healthy thing, because the way that schools teach are perhaps becoming outmoded, and that's not necessarily their fault. It's a big machine, but the world is changing rapidly.
It was the joy of standing back and watching my class developing their critical thinking, working in groups, being creative in the responses, learning not to jump just at the first thing they come to, and then sometimes sheer joy and sometimes the sheer frustration in their faces when they get things right or they get things wrong. I think what it's done for my students has been the most exciting thing for me.
So education doesn't just benefit parents and children, it has a positive impact on the rest of society and indigenous culture in general. But what kids generally don't have access to is the world of work.
Sometimes it's hard for them to see, like, oh, I'm in school, I'll never be a real designer, because that's the real world, but it's the same world. Sort of the ambassador role gives them that bridge to say, hang on a minute, like, not so long ago she was in my shoes. And now she's found this amazing thing and, you know, it is possible. I can do this. I can totally do this.
They're getting to do real life briefs and real life problems and gain that understanding of what creativity is. Because I think creativity is a very hard thing to teach. And some people tend to say they're not creative. So I think it's about teaching everyone that everyone can be creative in their own way.
There's a misconception that creativity is just painting and pottery. But actually, creativity is everything in the world. And critical thinking, creative problem solving, that's given a new platform and a new lesson in schools. So you can have creative maths, you have creative, you know, it filters into English, it filters into sciences. All these subjects can benefit from a new lesson which teaches the three core skills that Daydream Believers is doing.
When I was at school, I did okay, but every report card every year always used to say, Neil has a tendency to daydream, and that used to really annoy me and my parents more so. The irony now is that I'm now in a job that's a job I love and pays really well. My job every day is to daydream. So that's why I'm passionate to be part of a project that's called Daydream Believers, that actually will allow kids to be proud to daydream and use that to make potentially the world a better place.
My name is Chris.
Jenny Kello.
Katie Simpson.
Ryan Grieve.
Ross Angus. Neil Walker.
Shona Primrose.
Ashley Lowe.
Lauren Gilfillan. And I am a Daydream Boomer.
So, what you saw there was footage from the kind of early stages of the program and the lessons that these guys created and piloted in these schools with these amazing teachers are the lessons that are on the webpage. And I think, you know, when we first started, one of the initial things that teachers said, but it's okay, you know, I'm further away in Scotland, I'm not in Edinburgh, how do I get the real world into my classroom? And I think that if anything, just the very fact, if you look around this Zoom call, if you look around this Teams meeting, doors had closed at the start of lockdown. Our A to B was no longer certain. But look at this gathering of people and be inspired that doors are opening. So employers are more capable and more interested in coming into your classrooms than ever before. We, on my course, have brought employers in. Many of them were in little rooms. Chris Davey, that you saw there, was, I think, in his wife's wardrobe, was the only way I could describe where he lived was at that time. And they shared what they were working on. This is what's on my screen at the minute. This is this problem. So when we bring it back, there's a knowledge and there's a community. And that community is open and willing to work with us to reimagine education in a way that perhaps even before this we could never have imagined. So I just want to say a massive thank you, taking an hour out on a Wednesday. I don't know about you, but I get confused about days. So somebody bought me days of the week socks, which have been really helpful, just a kind of a throwaway out there. You know, if you're never sure, just so I glance down, yeah, it's Wednesday. But I just want to thank you so much for being with us. I want to thank the amazing team. I am one of a large group of people. A particular shout out to the teachers, to Katie, to Philippa, and Shona, and to Emil and Chris who are on the team. Just a massive thank you to them. And a thank you to George and to Education Scotland. And I hope that you can join us. I hope that you do feel creatively brave. I hope in a small way that today's story, the story that I told, is one that you care about. And I really, really hope that you can help us. Pull your chair up to the table, come and join us, and let's reimagine education. Thank you so, so much. George, it's back to you.
Thank you very much for that. That was truly inspiring, and I think I've just seen somebody post a comment there saying that you've quite beautifully described blended learning and what that could look like, and I think that's absolutely spot on. And I think you made mention to it so many times that perhaps we've not been sure what our next steps have been since lockdown, and still don't know what our next steps are, and it is really going to require bravery there. And I think that's where we are so on board with that Daydream message. I think certainly we are organisation, and I think especially the digital team, because I think there is a bravery required to go and try new things, whether it's new tools or a new approach. And the wee bit I'd like to see, I think that alongside the great lessons that you've already got there with Daydream Believers, we've got our What Digital Learning Might Look Like document that might be. It's just a load of ideas for digital teaching. You know, be brave, try some things you've never done before. And I think as well, our webinars will hopefully support some people with that. And we have our Twitter and blog posts. So what I'd love is if people are being creatively brave, and it's whether it's, you know, using for the Creative Bravery Festival or just using Daydream Believers stuff as they go forward, to please share that with us on Twitter and maybe write a wee blog post to, because I think when people share their stories like you have, it inspires other people around them. So please share it with us and with Daydream Believers. Let us know how you're using it and the impact that's had. And I'd certainly like to hope that a lot of the people can think how they can be brave and creative digitally, and hopefully that's some of the examples you're going to get for the the festival will have a digital, whether it's, you know, coding or building a website, that side of the digital skills, or it's using video to capture the learning that they've done and trying something they've not done before. So I'll really look forward to seeing what comes from the festival and how people use that.